Do you have a welcome?
Welcome to worship this morning. We would like to welcome Hans back, who graces with his musical presence. And this morning we welcome Pastor Jay leading us in worship. Christmas Eve, Friday, 4 o'clock worship here, a service of readings and music. So all are welcome. Anything else anyone wants to bring up?
Is there an online service?
I think it will be recorded and put on. It won't be streaming at the same time.
Okay.
But it will, right, Laura, are you going to? Yeah, it will be like normal. She'll do it while it's going on and then.
And Alex and Laura did send a clip to put on as well.
To add to that?
Yes.
Okay. All right, thank you.
At every beginning, there is a yearning for the one who is coming. O Emmanuel, surprise us by your coming. We gather together to let God's good news reorient our lives. O Emmanuel, surprise us by your coming. We wait for the day when all the world will see the sign that God is with us. O Emmanuel, surprise us by your coming. We are shocked by how God comes close, even at this very moment. O Emmanuel, surprise us by your coming. Jesus, we welcome your presence now with the lighting of these candles, whose flames bring warmth to winter and fill this place with the glow of hope. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. God of all time, your word became flesh and walked among us. Receive our gratitude and awe for all that you have done through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Thank you. The reading today is from Psalm 130. I wait for the Lord. My soul waits, and in his word I hope. My soul waits for the Lord, more than those who watch for the morning, more than those who watch for the morning. O Israel, hope in the Lord, for with the Lord there is steadfast love, and with him is great power to redeem. It is he who will redeem Israel from all its iniquities. The word of God. The scripture reading today is from 1 John. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through him, and without him, not one thing came into being. What has come into being in him was life, and the life was the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. There was a man sent from God, whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify to the light, so that all might believe through him. He himself was not the light, but he came to testify to the light. The true light, which enlightens everyone, was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world came into being through him. Yet the world did not know him. He came to what was his own, and his own people did not accept him. But to all who received him, who believed in his name, he gave power to become children of God, who were born not of blood or of the will of the flesh or of the will of man, but by God. And the Word became flesh and lived among us, and we have seen his glory, the glory as of a Father's only Son, full of grace and truth. John testified to him and cried out, "This was he of whom I said, 'He who comes after me ranks ahead of me, because he was before me.' From his fullness we have all received grace upon grace. The law indeed was given through Moses. Grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. No one has ever seen God. It is God, the only Son, who is close to the Father's heart, who has made him known." The word of God.
Thanks be to God.
Friends, grace and peace to you in Jesus' name. Amen. When my daughter was 8 months old, our family was moving from Colorado to Wisconsin to begin a new call. Now, my daughter wasn't walking yet, to be sure, but she had begun to move around vociferously. Everywhere she went, she could go as quickly as possible. She was crawling, pulling herself up on every object. And so this made packing very difficult, because she had, like many children that age, developed the uncanny ability to seek out and find the most dirty and dangerous thing in the room and go directly there. Which meant that as we were attempting to put things in boxes, she could get into those boxes, which meant we couldn't leave anything out that was too small to swallow, that was too sharp that it might cut, that was too heavy that it might fall and crush a finger or a toe. In addition to that, my daughter developed an absolutely hysterical fear of the sound of packing tape being torn from its right. And our house was only 750 square feet, and so there was no way that she could be far enough away from the sound of us finally packing a box to not lose her ever-loving mind. We were not making much progress, and so we decided that the best solution was to send my wife and my daughter on a plane to Wisconsin, and I stayed behind for 3 weeks and packed up the rest of the house and closed out our ministry in Colorado. Now, during those days, as those of you who have ever known an infant know, every single day you have a completely different child, right? They learn something new. They look different. They develop a new guess at a word. Those precious, precious moments, day after day after day. I didn't want to miss those over those 3 weeks that I was packing up our house alone. And so we arranged to Skype, to, you know, video chat each evening at bedtime. That was our plan, at least. And so the first evening that my wife and daughter were in Wisconsin, we turned on our computers and we set up the video call, and it was horrible. Because my daughter knew my face, and she knew my voice, but she also knew my skin, having held her skin to skin just moments after her birth. And she knew my smell, and she knew my beard, and she knew my heartbeat and my breath. And so when she saw me on the computer screen and heard my voice, she wanted to touch me and to be held by me. And so she started pawing at the screen, and nothing happened. And so then she would crawl behind the computer thinking that we were playing some weird game of peekaboo, and that didn't work either. And then she just lost it. And so, of course, her mother and I did as well. And so we quit. And for 3 weeks, we just didn't see each other. And I think about that experience every time I encounter the first chapter of the Gospel of John. Today, we are met by John's telling of what has come to be known as the Christmas story. It's a peculiar story because it doesn't have any of these characters, right? Like, there is no manger, there are no shepherds, there's no pregnant mother, there's no father. That none of that stuff is there. But rather, when John tells the story of how Jesus came into the world, John begins in the beginning. And he tells this epic, huge story about how in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and the Word was the light and the life of all of creation, and through the Word all things came into being, and nothing came into being except through the Word. And it's this beautiful, cosmic, incredible, eternal story. And it is told in beautiful poetry. And it can be quite lovely to listen to. To hear that the light shines in the darkness and the darkness cannot overcome it. And yet, this idea of a God who is Word, the Word, through whom all things came into being, calling to mind images of Genesis, where in the beginning, where there was chaos and darkness, God spoke, "Let there be light," and there was light, and God said, "Let there be creepy crawly things," and there were creepy crawly things, and God said, "Let there be seas and lakes," and there were seas and lakes. It's a beautiful image, but it's hard to grasp this cosmic, huge, eternal story from Monday through Saturday. Right? It's hard to hold tight to a God who is Word speaking into chaos and darkness in the beginning, calling forth life, when all I want to know is how I'm going to pay my bills this month, or what's going to happen the next time I go to the doctor, or what hope there might be for my marriage, or what it looks like to continue to live into this now almost 2-year-long global pandemic. Calling forth images of a God who is Word speaking logic and reason and plan and order into chaos is lovely. But what does it mean tangibly, day after day? What difference does it make in our actual lives? And this is a struggle that John knew well also, because John lived in a heady, heady time, a time not terribly unlike our own, a time of empire, a time of oppression, a time of deep and abiding poverty and hunger, a time of rampant disease, a time of violence and war and rumors of war, a time of deep political division, a time of you name it. They lived it. And John could tell the story of how generation after generation, the word would speak into the people's lives and the people would listen, maybe on occasion, but the people were distracted and confused and obsessed with their daily lives and living in conditions that made it hard to sit around and ponder what it meant to belong to a God who speaks, a God who reasons, a God who plans, a God who casts visions. When we're living in the here and now and the day to day. And so the climax of this beautiful poem, this hymn that John sings of this cosmic and eternal God, is when that God, that word, that wisdom, that logic, that reason, that light, that life, that plan, that everything becomes flesh and dwells among us. Literally in Greek, sets up camp, tabernacles, pitches a tent, becomes present as a meeting place, as a spot, a camping ground. This God who makes all things and makes all things new has come to dwell with us. So John casts this vision of a God who knows everything, who is everything, who casts everything into being, and yet is not content to remain in the heavens to be seen and heard as word and light, but rather longs to hold and be held, to touch and be touched, to live fully enfleshed among us, so that God might meet us where we are and know who and what we are and how we live. And so the climax of John's Christmas story is a God who chooses to suffer and rejoice right alongside us. A God who chooses to know what it is to have indigestion, to give birth, to weep at a grave, to wait for test results, to be excluded, to break bones, to have trouble breathing, to be desperately lonely, to be confused about what to do next, to sit at a kitchen table and wonder what bills are not going to get paid this month. A God who knows what it is to struggle through every aspect of what it means to be alive. A God who walks alongside us in all our joyful and difficult journeys. This is the God whom we gather to celebrate and sing at Christmas and all year long. A God who was not content to stay enthroned in the heavens, but instead chose to set up camp and to meet us where we are, so that we might step by step by step move forward through the dirtiest and most dangerous places in creation, to find the light at the end of the tunnel, to find the life that breathes beyond the shadow of death. This is the God who is born in the manger, who weeps at the tomb, who is broken on the cross, and who accompanies you from Monday to Saturday through whatever it is you face this week. And the good news doesn't stop there. Because as we know, the story goes that this God was born among us. The Word became flesh as the babe born in Bethlehem grew to be the Savior of the world, the Messiah who preached and healed and resurrected, and then ascended into the heavens, where now, if we don't pay attention, we could believe that this God has departed again and is now again this Word, this light, this life, this grace, this truth, this reason, this logic, this thing, this ethereal spirit, if you will, that reigns in the heavens while we still muddle through our daily lives. But no, this God is so desperate to hold and be held, to touch and be touched, to be present in the dirt and the danger of our lives, that in the night in which he was betrayed, he left behind a gift of bread and wine. God's own body and blood, enfleshed presence, thick and real among us, so that each and every week as we gather at this table, we might feel on our lips, our teeth, our tongue, in our belly, and our bowels the very presence of this God, this light, this life, this truth, this grace, still with us now, walking step by step through whatever we face from Monday through Saturday, still present among us as staple food to fill our hungry bodies and festive drink to bring us joy in the midst of sorrow. This God is with us still and will be until all is said and done. And so as we muddle our way through another hard year, and as we approach again the darkest and longest night, and as we face whatever it is we face, as the light slowly begins to return, and as hope is born anew, we gather at this table to taste and see, to hold and feel, to take into our own flesh and blood a God who is with us, who is Emmanuel, who is grace upon grace, walking with us through everything we face, no matter what, and forever. And thanks be to God for that. Amen.
Thank you.
You're invited to stand as we pray for the whole world and all people according to their needs. O God, for whom we wait, we pray today for all people everywhere who are living in fear, waiting for hope, longing for peace and for promise. We pray for nations torn apart by war, for populations suffering in poverty and hunger, for people everywhere living in fear, that they might know your peace and your presence in their lives. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for your church in every corner of creation, the place where you meet the people in bread and wine, water and word, where you come to meet us with grace and fill us with hope and promise, that the church everywhere and always might be a voice of justice and peace, compassion and healing, mercy and hope in a broken world. We pray especially for our companion synods in the Meru Diocese of Tanzania and El Salvador, the partner congregation of Reformation in Milwaukee, that everywhere and always your word might be met with joy and might plant in every heart a seed of hope and promise and a fire for justice. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for all those who suffer and struggle anywhere, especially those who struggle with health issues, who live with grief, who wait for test results, who long to know your peace and presence in their family. We pray especially for Judy, Wendy, Donna, Nancy, Dorothy, Marge, Ruth, Sandy, George, Aaron, Angie, Anna, Brock, Mark, Stacy, Kevin, Todd, Andy, Cassandra, Nicole, Elnetta, Ken, Steve, Jim, Alice, Mary Pat, Becky, Jeffrey, Terry. We pray for all those who live with mental illness, who live and struggle with addiction, who suffer in the midst of this ongoing pandemic, who are hungry or thirsty, who are homeless or underhoused, who live in poverty or who live in the midst of violence and abuse. May your peace and presence be with them and give them hope. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for all those who have died in your promise, who live with you, and whose lives shine forth paths for us to follow. We give you thanks for the gift of baptism that wrapped them in promise and encompasses and carries us as well. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Into your hands, gracious God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. The beloved is with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. In the night in which our Lord Jesus was betrayed, he took bread, blessed it, broke it, and gave it to the disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, gave it to them to drink, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." We remember our Lord as we pray the prayer he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. All are welcome. Thanks be to God. Amen. You may be seated.
Christ broken for you.
You're invited to stand. May the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and hold you in God's grace. And may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord's face smile on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and grant you peace. Amen. Go in peace to serve the beloved. Thanks be to God.